By 1800, Napoleon was securely established as first consul of France. It had been a meteoric rise. He could now shape the country according to his will and put his own stamp on the course of world events. Napoleon's heroes were the likes of Alexander the Great and Charlemagne, visionary men who combined ambition with overwhelming military skill. Now, Napoleon was poised to make a similar contribution to world history. His genius as a soldier and tactician had won him a host of victories, forging in the process an army that was both battle-hardened and fiercely loyal to its young commander.
By 1800, the world was at Napoleon's feet. He was a national hero of unparalleled popularity. He had defeated the Austrians, he had defeated the British, he had opened up Egypt to the world, and now he had taken control of a French government that was almost universally unpopular. He was going to be the savior of France.
There's no return of the royalists to France. The church at this time still is effectively in exile. So many of the values of the revolution are still upheld by Napoleon. And I think he's seen very much as the flag of the revolution still at that time.
Now, Napoleon did not want to be another regime that went out within a year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. What he wanted to try and do was to stabilise what he saw as the achievement of the revolution while removing some of what he saw as its excesses.
In December 1799, Napoleon had stated to the French people, "Citizens, the revolution is confined to the principles which commenced it. It is finished." He had drawn a line under the revolution, and it was for him dead.
I think outside France, the response to Napoleon's seizure of power at Brumaire, 1799, was surprisingly favourable. They didn't know what was coming. And remember, they were looking back on a terrible decade of bloodshed inside and outside France. So when Napoleon arrives and announces that the revolution is over, there were a lot of people who wanted to believe him and to believe that stability had returned to France at last.
There had always been a deeply conservative streak in Napoleon's makeup. His love of power outweighed any commitment he may have had to democratic principles. Yet it was not power for its own sake that drove him. It gave him the freedom to influence the future of France and the events of a new century. As first consul, he had that power and immediately set about using it.
He had introduced, or shall we say improved, the secret police under Fouché, and he had a steady flow of information about anybody who could be a danger to his rule. He introduced a fairly rigid censorship, and from some 70 Parisian journals, he reduced them down to about 3 in a very short space of time. Nobody was allowed to publish anything that was in conflict with the principles of the government, his government.
I think Napoleon recognized that he had an opportunity due to the fact that France had become so polarized. Opinion had been so polarized by the terror, especially, that so much had unraveled during the course of the 1790s, that there was a tremendous opportunity for someone who stood above parties to take all those unraveled strands and put them back together again. And that can be seen in the fact that he was prepared to use anybody, any talents, no matter where they came from, so long as they served his purpose. He's always in control. But I don't think he bears a grudge against what had gone before, whether it was the Directory or indeed the old regime for that matter.
What did the supporters of the old regime, of the Bourbons, to be part of his grand coalition, if you will? He wanted, as much as anything, to have a united France. And for a time, the old regime was actually fairly favorable toward Napoleon, largely because they thought once he brought stability, once he got rid of some of the more radical elements of the revolution, that he, Napoleon, might very well bring back the king. In fact, Louis, the future Louis XVIII, wrote to Napoleon and said, "Ah, well done, my lad. Now, why don't you bring me back and all will be well?" And Napoleon wrote back very politely saying, "Sorry, but if you came back, it would be over the bodies of 100,000 dead Frenchmen." I mean, there was no way. Once they realized that Napoleon was not going to be a conduit for the return of the Louis, then they turned on Napoleon. And they made a number of efforts to assassinate Napoleon. The most famous of these efforts, of course, was the so-called Infernal Machine.
On Christmas Eve, 1800, Napoleon and Josephine were to attend a performance of Haydn's creation. They traveled in separate coaches. The royalists had rigged up an infernal machine, a bomb attached to a barrel of gunpowder. It was time to blow up the two coaches together. By sheer good fortune, a gap opened up between the coaches by the time they arrived. Napoleon and Josephine were unscathed, but 52 bystanders were maimed or killed.
That explosion, however, that effort, gave Napoleon an opportunity to eliminate some of his opponents.
There was, of course, a good deal of opposition to the Napoleonic regime after 1799. After all, most French people involved in politics after 1789 had got used to a culture of confrontation, to a culture of conflict, and they couldn't simply change in 1799. And so, of course, a great deal of opposition went on almost as a matter of instinct. There was opposition from the right, I need hardly say, from diehard Catholics and Royalists. There's opposition from the left, from old-style Jacobins. There's opposition from pretty well every possible quarter.
He always understood that other generals would see him in that position and say, "Well, gee, that could have been me, you know, and maybe it should have been me." But it wasn't, and Napoleon had to deal with that.
Generals whom he did not trust lost office, lost their positions in the army, or were placed in positions where they were not able to take individual, independent initiatives. And of course, once he was in control of the army, and he actively pushed the careers of those people who he could rely on, then he wasn't really concerned greatly about any other possible center of resistance.
On the left, you had the Jacobins. You had the diehard revolutionaries who weren't at all sure that a military man is more or less the single leader of France was what they had in mind. Napoleon's desire for order, which was undoubtedly good for the nation, may have raised the hackles of some of the Jacobins who thought that maybe the revolution should come back in a more pure form.
The Jacobins had a secret ally, Joseph Fouché, Napoleon's hated chief of police. He covered up for them and tried to divert Napoleon in the direction of the royalists. After all, they had been behind the infernal machine.
I don't think the Jacobins were a threat after 1799. They're few in number. They enjoy little support on the streets of Paris, which Napoleon was very careful to keep quiet through a combination of bread and circuses. And although they make a great deal of noise, I don't think they amounted to very much. It helped Napoleon. It helped him to keep the right and the centre-right under control by pretending that they're potentially very dangerous. And if they don't keep Napoleon in power, then it'll be back to the days of the Terror and so on and so forth.
130 Republicans were branded terrorists. A death sentence in all but name. Napoleon next turned his attention to the Catholic Church. Stripped of its influence and prestige by the Revolution, it had been rendered virtually powerless. Napoleon decided to reinstate it to a position of influence.
Napoleon's resumption on behalf of France of Catholicism was in a sense a political measure. He saw this as a way to stabilize the situation, and he was correct to actually follow an anti-church policy, an anti-religious policy, was not a way to enhance the stability of the regime.
He'd seen at first hand, especially in Italy, the force of Catholicism as an ideology and the Catholic Church as an institution in mobilizing popular opposition to the French regime. And he realized that if true domestic stability were to be returned to France, then some kind of arrangement with the Roman Catholic Church would have to be initiated.
At that point in time, Napoleon saw that there could be money to be made by allowing the church back into France, but it was not going to be the old church with its feudal rights and with its property. It was going to be Napoleon's church, like Henry VIII's Church of England. It was Napoleon's Church of France, and it did what he said.
She was committed to France.
Her reputation still lingers as this extraordinary woman who would do anything to destroy French people.
Committed to her king.
He was not very sexual.
The lovers she preferred were women.
And committed to her fate.
She had the bad luck to be at the wrong place at the wrong time.
Unraveling truth from myth.
Of course she didn't say, let them eat cake. She was intensely compassionate.
Reputations, Marie Antoinette, a UK history premiere, Tuesday at 7.
The Middle East, torn and tormented.
They are criminals, they are liars.
Our people are fed up with this condition.
The confrontations.
We warned the Russians, stay out of there.
And corruption.
I was approached by the biggest Jewish organization that I was making a huge mistake politically.
Make sense of recent crises.
What has been done, you will pay.
A UK history premiere, the award-winning 50 Years War starts Monday at 10.
Notre Dame on Easter Day, 1802, a mass was held to celebrate the new Concordat. Afterwards, Napoleon asked General Delmar whether he thought the service had been a success.
Pretty monkish mummery. The only thing missing were the million men who died to overthrow what you are now setting up again.
There was massive opposition to the Concordat inside France, from the left, from the old Jacobins, because the Concordat was the most visible sign that Napoleon was prepared to compromise with the old regime, here with the dominant ideology of the old regime. And so there was a good deal of muttering, and not all of it under their breath, on the part of a number of senior generals, for example, many of whom were Jacobin by orientation.
But even these sentiments did nothing to deflect Napoleon. On 4th of August, 1802, following a landslide victory and a plebiscite, Napoleon was made consul for life. In effect, he was now Emperor of France. The church was now firmly back at the center of French society. Equally importantly, it was also under the thumb of the new consul. But the restoration of the Catholic Church was only the first area of national life on which Napoleon determined to put his stamp. He saw himself in the tradition of the lawgivers of the ancient world. Introduced in stages, the Code Napoleon would ratify a new legal system in many areas of French life: marriage, education, the jury system. Napoleon had an official explanation for introducing the Code. The revolution had bred a spirit of extreme individualism.
It is necessary to throw upon the soil of France a few blocks of granite in order to give a direction to the public spirit.
There are many misconceptions about Napoleon and the Code Napoleon. Napoleon didn't write it himself. A body of legislation had already been started in 1792 and continued from then on. It was in 1792 and 1793 that the old feudal rights were swept away. Napoleon did not sweep them away, as is popularly believed. He merely ensured that they were embodied into his new Code Napoleon, which, as I say, was lying around in the parliamentary system when he came along. What he did, he ramrodded it through in 90 sessions so that it was a coherent and well thought out document which was passed into law. As, what else? The Code Napoleon.
The codification of French laws under the consulate, it becomes the Civil Code, is a very good example of how Napoleon went to work. He got the best people, he organized them, he motivated them, he controlled them, he kept them up to their work, not least by chairing some of the sessions himself. And then he was able to enforce it throughout France through a new centralized bureaucratic system introduced after 1799, based on the prefects.
However much the code purported to benefit the French people as a whole, it was not a move towards democracy and freedom. The only people who really benefited were those Napoleon saw as the social and economic backbone of his new society, the wealthy middle classes who had done so well out of the revolution.
At its root, the French Revolution was a middle class revolution with middle class ideals. And Napoleon was also, at his root, a middle class leader. His goals, his ideals, his policies were geared toward the middle class. Nowhere is this more true than in the field of education. A lot of folks don't realize that Napoleon made great strides to reorganize and reform and improve the French educational system, and that the curriculum ought to be that geared toward preparing people to be members of the middle class, to be government workers, to be military leaders, in short, to be the leadership cadre of France under Napoleon. This is not unlike the system anywhere in the world today. Education is largely a middle class kind of institution.
In 1802, Napoleon introduced a new honors system, the Legion of Honor. Someone suggested it should be an exclusively military honor. Napoleon disagreed.
If we make a distinction between military and civil honors, we shall be instituting two orders, whereas the nation is one. If we award honors only to soldiers, that will be still worse, for then the nation will cease to exist.
It met with fierce criticism, especially from the left. It was not egalitarian, but among the population at large, it was popular. In all, 30,000 people were decorated.
It was Napoleon who once said, "It is with baubles that men are led." And he is obviously quite right. I mean, you give a guy a star to pin on his coat and he feels 10 feet tall, rather like iron crosses in World War II. The Légion d'honneur was introduced in four grades. There was the chevalier, the officer, the commander, the grand eagle and grand officer. And it was open to all those on the field of battle who had achieved something of daring and of note. In that way, it was extremely democratic. And somebody who had won the Légion d'honneur could look to having Field Marshal Baton maybe slipped into his knapsack a day or two afterwards.
It was deeply resented by the old Jacobins as a sign that Napoleon was abandoning the egalitarian ideals of the revolution. And I think it has to be said that that is right. He was creating an elite and singling them out through the award of medals, through the award of a whole hierarchy of titles and uniforms and so on and so forth.
Napoleon may have been a national hero to the French, but he was not a man of the people. He created an even greater distance between himself and the people when he introduced a new nobility, the notables. These were local citizens who, by virtue of their wealth, paid the highest taxes. In return, they were given titles, official positions, and huge official salaries. On Sunday, 2nd December, 1804, in the Cathedral of Notre Dame, Pope Pius VII crowned Napoleon as Emperor of France. Almost as if the revolution had never happened, there was now a single ruler, a state church, an honor system, and a new nobility. But whatever the similarities, it was not the old France. It was a very new entity, ruled by the greatest military genius of the age. He was about to prove the point yet again in spectacular style.
Up until now, that the French army had been made up of a series of armies. So you had the Army of Italy, the Army of the Interior, the Army of Germany, and so on. With Napoleon now being the virtual dictator and the supreme military commander, it was important that there was just one army, and that became the Grand Army.
The Grand Army was an effective army. It was particularly well structured in the development of the corps system, which was essentially building on the earlier idea of the division. The point about the corps is that it enabled a commander of a corps to contain within that the three independent arms, infantry, cavalry and artillery, so that as an individual corps they could, as it were, cover the bases.
It was a standardized system which has been accepted throughout the world as being the best way to do the job. It's still used today.
In 1803, despite an interim period of peace, Britain and France were once more at war. By 1805, Britain had been joined by Austria, Russia, and Sweden in the Third Coalition. For the second time, Napoleon began to make plans for the invasion of Britain. Work began on the construction of specially designed vessels. A potential invasion force of over 150,000 troops was to be assembled. As he quickly learned, naval warfare demanded different skills from land warfare.
Napoleon invested a vast amount of money and time in preparing the invasion in the years up to 1803. There is no doubt that he meant to do it. He even had the idea of digging a tunnel under the channel, which was abandoned fairly rapidly. So, yes, certainly he intended to do it, but his admirals kept saying to him, you know, we can't just push the boats out and make them do what you want. We have to have the right winds at the right time. And this Napoleon could never comprehend.
Coordinating forces at sea was not like moving units on a battlefield. Obviously, once they were out of sight of land, it was virtually impossible to know where they were, and, you know, impossible, unless you could get a quicker ship to catch up with them, to send them messages. So the coordination of naval forces was very difficult.
One of the problems that Napoleon had was that there was no tradition of naval power in France. They had a navy, certainly. They had some very, very fine fighting ships. They even had a few good commanders, but they didn't have anything at all like the tradition of England.
They had been starved of adequate naval supplies. They couldn't renew the rigging on the boats. The spars were rotten in some cases. The hulls were creaking and leaking. The crews were rebellious under the spirit, the new spirit of republicanism. Many of the officers had emigrated to save their necks. Many other able officers preferred to go into the merchant marine, which they could happily do, because there at least was some money to be made from capturing foreign prizes.
And then with the imposition of a British blockade by the Royal Navy, the French Navy is cooped up in port, starved of resources, starved of men, and with no training. And so every time the French Navy goes to sea and takes on, or almost every time they go to sea and take on the Royal Navy, they get a bloody nose. And that leads in part to the disaster at the Battle of the Nile, Aboukir Bay, in 1798, and then most spectacularly, of course, to Trafalgar.
It was already clear prior to Trafalgar that the situation did not permit an invasion of Britain. Indeed, the French army was already moved into Germany for the Ulm-Austerlitz campaign. So that, in fact, the fleet which sailed out of Cadiz, which was a French and Spanish fleet, was not intended to invade Britain. It might have been that if that fleet hadn't been destroyed, that subsequently it would have been used in an attempt to cover an invasion after the defeat of Austria. But actually, in 1805, by the time of Trafalgar, what Napoleon is most concerned about is to get ships into the Mediterranean to help his campaign in Italy.
With the threat of invasion removed, you can argue that the British no longer had any incentive to come to peace terms with Napoleon, that they had all of the reasons in the world not to come to peace terms. The British were determined to maintain a balance of power on the continent, and to do this, they could not tolerate a France that was too strong. It was not enough just to have naval dominance, because if Napoleon could control all of the continent, he could establish a navy. It might take some time, but he could do it, and then it might be possible for it to have an invasion.
As the Allies made plans of their own in mainland Europe, it must have seemed that the Emperor's attention was diverted elsewhere. But Napoleon's Grande Armée had used its time on the Channel coast to rest and retrain. It could and would now be employed to devastating effect. Intelligence reports had reached Napoleon at Boulogne that the coalition planned an ambitious multi-pronged attack. A force made up of British, Russian, and Swedish troops would attack Hanover from the north. An Austrian army, under General Mack, would invade Bavaria, supported by a large Russian contingent. Another Austrian army was to strike towards Lombardy from northern Italy, whilst a force under Archduke John of Austria attacked the Tyrol. In the south, a mixed nationality force would launch an assault on Naples. Napoleon, with the Grande Armée at its fighting peak, preempted the coalition's plans by making a swift and decisive move against General Mack in Bavaria. He would remove Mack from the game even before his Russian support had arrived. The Allies, lacking Napoleon's intelligence network, believed wrongly that he would strike first in Italy. They were completely unprepared. Once more, the little corporal descended like a thunderbolt. Once more, the Austrians reeled before him.
It's hard to imagine moving tens and tens of thousands of soldiers all the way from the French coastline into Germany in secrecy. But he, to a very large extent, accomplished that. He also accomplished it in an incredibly short period of time, a mere matter of weeks. Now, the first Austrian force he encountered was at Ulm, under the command of General Mack. General Mack had not a clue that Napoleon was about to encircle him. He almost literally wakes up one morning and discovers that the French have him surrounded.
So as Mack realizes that his lines of communication are finally being severed by Napoleon's movement sur la derrière, apart from a fleeing cavalry force under the Archduke Ferdinand, Mack realizes the game is up, and with his 25,000 men he surrenders to Napoleon, presenting himself as the unfortunate General Mack. And then Napoleon does take great glee in returning his sword and sending him back to the Emperor of Austria with the news of his own demise.
The maneuver around the rear of the Austrian force at Ulm in 1805 was a masterpiece of planning and reflects nothing but glory on the Grande Armée, from Napoleon through Berthier and the general staff all the way down to the guys who were trudging along the roads. It was a masterpiece. Its importance lay not in taking the city of Ulm, which is in a very in a position very difficult to defend anyway, but its importance lay in the capture of the unfortunate General Mack, 25,000 Austrians, the demoralization which pervaded the entire Austrian army after this debacle, and the moral ascendancy that he won over his Austrian and Russian foes when he went forward to fight them again at Austerlitz.
The action against Austria had brought Prussia perilously close to joining the coalition. Napoleon decided on another preemptive strike to weaken the Russians before Prussia could add her weight to that of the Allies. He moved towards the Russians, who were advancing under General Kutuzov. When he learned of the Austrian collapse at Ulm, Kutuzov retreated, keeping one step ahead of the pursuing French. He doubled back across the Danube, cleverly eluding Napoleon, and linking up with the army of General Boxhauden near the town of Olmutz. For once, Napoleon had been outmaneuvered. On 23rd November 1805, at Brunn, 45 kilometers from Olmutz, the Grande Armée rested after their long march from the French coast. They were exhausted and outnumbered, but their finest hour was coming.
Now, at this point, Napoleon's position is not nearly as good as it had been earlier. His lines of communication are much longer, his soldiers are much tireder, he sent various portions of his army out into other areas searching for the main body of Austrians and Russians who have now entered the fray. So by the time he gets to Austerlitz, he's got a little bit of a problem. He no longer has the dominant force, he's no longer got the element of surprise, and so he has to resort to some other way of assuring victory.
Napoleon's early skill as an artillery officer had trained him to understand how landscape could be used against an enemy. He surveyed the area around Brunn.
Gentlemen, examine this ground carefully. It is going to be a battlefield.
Dividing his force, he ordered one-third of his army under Soult, Murat, and Lahn to take possession of the village of Austerlitz and the adjacent Pratzen Heights. They were to be set up to look like sitting ducks to the numerically superior Russians. Cleverly, Napoleon cultivated the appearance of weakness, receiving Russian envoys and apparently keen to consider peace terms. The Russians didn't know that 22,000 reinforcements would arrive unseen and unsuspected. The French were made to look even weaker when Napoleon withdrew them from the Pratzen Heights.
Now, you don't normally give up the high ground in a battle if you've already got it, unless you're about to leave. And so he gives up the high ground, and the Russians and the Austrians are astounded, you know. They say, what? Okay, fine. So they immediately, of course, move on to the Pratzen Heights, or out looking over the whole area. I've stood on the Pratzen Heights, you can see for miles.
The trap was set. The bait had been brilliantly prepared. General Kutuzov's Russian bear needed little urging to take it. The Russians attacked the French right, but were soon hit by a counterattack. This meant the Russians had to take reinforcements from the Pratzen Heights.
Napoleon, with the main body of his army, is shielded below the base of the Pratzen Heights, behind a slight ridge, and a fortuitous thick fog. The Austrians and Russians have no idea he's there. When enough of the Allied forces have descended down after the French right flank, Napoleon gives the order and his forces storm the Pratzen Heights. They realize the mistake up there on the hill and they try to recall some of their soldiers to defend the Pratzen Heights, but it's too late. Napoleon is able to force his way onto the Pratzen Heights, splitting the armies of his opponents in half. He sends some folks after the retreating Russians. They are able to retreat more or less in decent order, but then he descends on the Austrians. He's now got them sandwiched in between the forces they thought they were pursuing and the forces of Napoleon up on top of the hill, and they are crushed.
As the day wore on, the Russian retreat turned to shambolic nightmare. Harried by the French, the Russians fled south towards the frozen lake surrounding the heights. Napoleon ordered the French artillery to shoot holes in the ice. In a horrific finale, an insult to those who had fought so bravely, large numbers of men and horses died in the icy waters. When the British Prime Minister Pitt heard the news, he was shattered.
Roll up that map of Europe. It will not be needed these 10 years.
Austerlitz has been seen by some as Napoleon's finest hour. This, of course, is always a tricky issue. I mean, is greatness to be judged, or military greatness to be judged in terms of victory, or sometimes in terms of staving off defeat in very difficult circumstances?
He had demonstrated he was so far above his opponents. He was so superior to them in planning, in conception, in managing his assets on the battlefield and off it. In judging the character of his enemies, in manipulating their weaknesses and reducing their strengths. Yes, this has got to be his finest.
It epitomised Napoleonic warfare in terms of the men and material used, in terms of his strategy, in terms of tactics on the battlefield, this was it. This was the perfect example of how a battle could be fought, how a battle should be fought. There's no textbook lesson that can be derived from it. It was just something that was perfect.
Labourites and Jews jammed the fascist route, resisting the peaceful efforts of the outnumbered police to clear the way. Now the crowd take matters into their own hands as the anti-fascist demonstrators resist efforts to disperse them.
UK history, the time and the place. Now there is no...
With the military plans of the coalition in tatters, Austria sued for peace, as her Russian allies retreated through Poland to lick their wounds. For Napoleon, the political map of Europe was waiting to be drawn according to his own designs.
I do not believe that Napoleon ever negotiated a peace. He was incapable of doing so. He negotiated truces when it suited him. But that was only with a view to making war later on terms more advantageous to himself. I don't think that he was psychologically capable of ever making peace with any other power. And the reason for that is that I don't think, although however mad this may sound, that he had aims. That was the secret to success in warfare, according to Clausewitz, was limited aims. And that's what Frederick the Great, for example, had done. He used war as an instrument. When he'd achieved his objective, he stopped. But Napoleon had no objectives. He allowed success in war to generate those objectives. And once they'd been attained, if he were still winning, as he, of course, he was until the end, he went on to some more aims. There was no sense of any clear, coherent aim which would enable him to say, I've achieved what I wanted to achieve, so I can now make peace.
Austerlitz is followed by peace with Austria, and a rather difficult peace in terms of the Austrians, loss of territory, humiliation. But war continues with Russia, and in 1806 is to be widened by the entry of Prussia into the war.
On 7th of August 1806, Prussia declared war on France and began to mobilize an army of 146,000 men. Within weeks, Russia and Britain had joined her in the Fourth Coalition. Once again, the Grande Armée and its seemingly invincible commander would take to the field.
The politics of 1806 are very complex. The Prussians didn't particularly want to fight Napoleon, but Napoleon pushed and intimidated and bullied them, and they themselves tried to respond to the opportunities of Russia and Britain being at war with France, and in the end Prussia comes into the war. Now Prussia had not been in the war since 1795, her military in the meantime had not really been developed, whereas the French military had become much more proficient. And Napoleon takes out, there's no other term that one can use really, Prussia in 1806 in an extraordinarily successful campaign.
On 13th October, Napoleon received news that a large Prussian force had gathered at Jena, a town on the River Saal near Leipzig. A furious battle ensued. The Prussians, under Prince Hohenlohe, fought bravely, but were no match for the numerically superior Grande Armée. By midday, the French had the upper hand. The Prussians, exposed and outnumbered, began to suffer terrible losses. Soon, they were in retreat. Once again, Napoleon had emerged victorious. This time, there was a sting in the tail. He had believed that at Jena, he had faced the main Prussian force. That night, on returning to his headquarters, he received astounding news.
Way away, about 20 kilometers away to the north, at Auerstedt, Davout, with his first corps, had in fact blundered into the major part of the Prussian army. Davout was one of Napoleon's most competent corps commanders. His achievements this day were absolutely legendary. With his one corps occupying the vital ground of Hassenhausen, he held the field against almost the entire Prussian army and inflicted extremely heavy casualties against it. Napoleon refused at first to believe that he had only attacked and beaten the smaller part of the Prussian army and that Davout had done the man's job that day. And if you look at the battle honours of the French regiments involved there, you will find that they all get Jena, nobody gets Auerstedt.
This was not at all surprising. I mean, the same could be true of, could be said of the 1800 campaign of Marengo. This was part of the pattern of military activity that the person at the top generally claims the credit for their subordinates.
At home, the news of his victory against Prussia did not provoke the same enthusiasm as his exploits at Austerlitz. The French people, unlike their emperor, were war-weary. Conscription had seen a steady stream of young men march off to feed Napoleon's war machine. Soon, they would be marching to Poland. There, the Russians, under General Bennigsen, were waiting for them. On 6 February 1807, in a howling blizzard, the two armies met in one of Napoleon's bloodiest encounters yet. At Eylau, what began as a skirmish ended in a full-scale battle with terrible loss of life.
In many ways, Eylau was comparable to Gettysburg. It was an accident. Both armies were in the neighbourhood of the town of Eylau at this time. The French did not intend to provoke a battle on the evening of the day. The Russians were close up to Eylau, but not in possession. All of a sudden, up rolled Imperial headquarters. The Russian patrol, which discovered them, alerted headquarters, and there was an attempt to evict them. This dragged more and more people in from both sides, and it developed into an extremely nasty affair, very close fought, very bloody, an awful lot of dead and wounded.
Eylau was a blood fest. It was a disaster for both sides. It was fought in a snowstorm. It was an old-fashioned slug each other until you both drop kind of affair. At the end, the casualties on both sides were enormous. Did anyone really gain any strategic advantage? You could argue perhaps the French gained a little bit, but nothing that could justify the carnage on the field. It was really one of the least advantageous and least happy battles, if you will, of the entire Napoleonic epoch.
Even Napoleon, for whom war was akin to a natural state, was appalled by the carnage at Eylau.
The countryside is covered with dead and wounded. This is not the pleasantest part of war. One suffers, and the soil is oppressed to see so many sufferers.
Rather than press the campaign against the Russians, he withdrew to winter quarters. On the face of it, Eylau was yet another victory in Napoleon's battle roll of honour. But it had been a costly and fortunate victory. On top of that, the Russian threat had not been eliminated. With the end of winter, the campaign resumed. Another French victory followed at the Battle of Friedland. This time, the outcome was more decisive. The Russians now sought peace. This came with the signing on 3rd July 1807 of the Treaty of Tilsit. It left Napoleon virtually master of Europe, with an even freer hand to shape the political map of the continent. All this had come at a high price. Blood, misery, and warfare marked the little corporal's rise. The one could not have happened without the other.
I feel myself driven toward an end I do not know. As soon as I have reached it, as soon as I shall become unnecessary, an atom will suffice to shatter me. Till then, not all the forces in mankind can do anything against me.
There's a view of Napoleon held by some, that he was a warmonger, that he was only interested in conquest, that he wanted to capture all of Europe for his own benefit, for his own aggrandizement. I don't believe that, and I think history will show clearly that that's not the case. Napoleon saw war as a means to an end.
There are different ways of looking at history. One way generally sees violence as a necessary way to overcome an old order in order to create the new. My own view is that that is a belief rather than an analysis. One could equally argue that people underrate the ability of existing systems to engender change, and that therefore the violence that one sees in episodes such as Napoleon or later the violence of the 20th century revolutions were not ones that one should necessarily see as progressive forces, and in some respects they actually made it harder to advance whatever one might regard as progressive.
By 1808, whatever was driving Napoleon had taken him to the throne of France, a position of unequaled influence in Europe and a further string of military victories. These had been the years of his zenith. More was to follow, but in future, the most powerful man in Europe wouldn't have everything his own way.
What more do we know today about the life of Christ? In the first in a three-part series, Jeremy Bowen tells the story of the Son of God, beginning tomorrow at the same time. The campaigns of Napoleon continues on UK History in a few minutes, as the tide of triumph turns in the Peninsular Wars.